No. All righty. Good evening and welcome to the December 14th Springs Municipal Advisory Council meeting. We welcome all our audience and our council members. Karina, do you want to make the announcement of Spanish interpretation?
Thank you, Chair Torrey. Buenas tardes. Esta reunión cuenta con interpretación al español. Para escuchar la reunión en español, vaya a la pantalla, a la parte baja de su pantalla, a la derecha encontrará el icono global o de interpretación. Haga clic y seleccione español, automáticamente estará escuchando nuestro intérprete Juan Morales. Gracias. Thank you, Chair Torrey.
Thank you. Vice Chair Perot, would you like to do the roll?
Yes, thank you. Council Member Lombard?
Present. Thank you.
Councilmember Reyes, I think we're still waiting on Mary Carmen. Councilmember Alcaraz, Councilmember Winders,
present.
Councilmember Hardiman,
present.
I am here, and Chair Maite is here.
All righty, thank you so much. Just a reminder that to encourage participation from all our council members this evening. Also want to thank KSVY for their broadcasting, Lynn Marie for her amazing minute taking, and of course our amazing interpreter Juan. And thank you to Karina for all the support that she offers to make this meeting happen every month. So thank you all. Can I get approval? Or any suggestions or changes to the November 9th? And we're also approving the November 28th minutes. We'll do those in two motions, but just seeing if there are any changes or additions to those minutes. Seeing none, is there a motion to approve the November 9th meeting minutes?
All motion.
Second?
I'll second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay, motion passes. The November 28th special meeting minutes.
I'll also motion.
Thank you. Second?
I'll second.
All in favor?
Aye.
All righty. Thank you so much. We do not have our youth voice tonight, but we will have them back in January. That's a new addition that we have, and we're excited to continue that tradition. Tonight, we will take public comment on any items not on the agenda. The time, the number of minutes or seconds you have depends on the number of people we have making comments. Karina will help time the comments. And if there's a show of hands to see if there's anyone who wants to make a public comment this evening. Do we have anyone? Oh, we have a few. Okay. So we'll do 2 minutes for each person. Would you like to promote the first?
Happy to do that, Chair Torrey. Let me reset my timer. In this order, it will be Andrea, Jim Silverman, and Mike.
Great.
Andrea, if you can unmute, and when you see the timer on your screen, if you can begin your comment and state your name for the public record, please.
Hi there.
Go ahead.
Okay, great, thank you. My name's Andrea Ockman-Collins. I am the executive director of Credo High School in Roanoke Park. We are a public Waldorf high school explicitly serving 6 K-8 charter schools in the North Bay, including Woodland Star in Sonoma Valley in the Springs, as well as Stonebridge School in Napa, among others, and would like the this group's support in advocating for a public bus route that would link Sonoma Valley directly with the route supporting the Santa Rosa JC, Credo High School, Tech High, and Sonoma State University. Currently, there's no direct public transit route that supports these students. So as a matter of equity, as a matter of carbon resources and getting more cars off the road, We're really hoping that you can agendize this item and provide support for us. Credo has at least 55 students, and among, you know, the JC, Stonebridge, Sonoma State, there are many more that would be served by this extra bus route. Thank you.
Andrea, my apologies. You have an additional 40 seconds. I added a minute, 20 seconds, and Chair Turi said 2 minutes, if you have more to add.
Sure. Let's see, what would I add? For context, our families at Credo advocated a number of years ago to extend an existing line from Sebastopol to Cotati. So that's a model for what I would hope would happen here. What the bus, the 26 route from Sebastopol to Cotati is extended by a mile in the morning and then again in the afternoon. So eastbound in the morning from Sebastopol to Rohnert Park, and then in the afternoon westbound. That route drops right at Credo. And so that's what we'd be looking for. I think it's the 40 route from Sonoma. If once in the morning coming west and once in the afternoon going east, it were extended to include the JC, the Rohnert Park schools, including Sonoma State, that would be a huge service to many students.
Thank you, Andrea. Jim, if you can go ahead and unmute, state your name and begin your comment when you see the timer on screen.
Thank you. My name is Jim Silverman, and I want to thank Supervisor Gorin for a community investment grant supporting a free Sonoma Plaza history storytelling tour. It's a mobile tour in English and in Spanish. We are working hard to tell the stories of disappeared people, all of the folks who have made our place a very special place to live. We're interested in reaching out within the community through local programs, working with the Boys and Girls Club and La Luz to make history a very personal kind of relationship for the people living here, growing up here, and visiting here as well. So we're working with the Sonoma Community Center on this project. And our goal is to start a whole bunch of conversations that include a whole bunch of people. So we're very grateful for the support, and I wanted to chime in with a thank you.
Thank you, Jim. Give me 1 second. Mike, go ahead. If you can hear us, if you can state your name and begin your comment when you see the screen, the timer on the screen.
Oh, shoot. I'm having some technical problems. I have to pass.
Oh, we can hear you.
Yeah, but I can't see the document that I wanted to read from.
I understand.
I can't see it on the screen, so I can't read it. I'm trying to get it up on my laptop, so just pass
me. We will come back to you. Yes, we will come back to you. Linda, if you can hear us.
Yes, I can hear you.
Okay, let me get the timer on the screen. Go ahead.
Hi, my name's Linda Odetto, and I am here to advocate for the direct bus line to Credo, Tech High, Sonoma State, and Santa Rosa Junior College from Sonoma. I am a Credo High parent, and I have been one of the parents who has been organizing the carpools out of Sonoma to get kids to Credo High. And it's not an easy feat, not by any means. And there are several parents who can't participate in carpools or can barely participate in carpools, and it makes it very difficult for them to find a carpool that they can join, because driving is part of, you know, a requirement of it. I'd also like to thank Jennifer Palladini for doing all of the work to get Susan Gorin on board with this. I cannot tell you how stressful it is for students to have to try to get from Sonoma to any schools in Roner Park. And especially for the working parents, it's incredibly difficult, incredibly stressful. I know I was going to say something else and now I can't think of what it was. But Yes. It takes 2 hours plus to get from Sonoma to Credo High School on any given day by transit, no matter what time of day you're going. Like, I just checked and it's almost 2 hours to get there from here right now.
That does conclude your time. Thank you.
Yeah.
And Mike, we will go back to you. Are you, if you're ready? Mike, can you hear us?
He shows he's muted.
Mike, can you hear us? Are you prepared to make your comment?
I can't seem to find the letter, so I'm gonna have to pass.
Understood. Thank you. That concludes public comment, Chair Turi.
Mike, you can email that to us when you find it, if you'd like.
Oh, it's in here someplace among, you know, a couple of dozen items that I have open. I'm just not familiar with this process. But anyway, thanks, and I'll mail it to you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
I think I see one other. I thought I saw Alondra's hand up. No, maybe not. Okay. Thank you. All right. Thank you for the public comment, everyone. We do have Sonoma County Transit coming up on our agenda in the near future, which would be a good opportunity for the folks talking about transit to come back and participate in that meeting as well. Karina, do we know what the, do we have that scheduled?
Yes, I know it's in 2023. Birdies are especially happy today, I apologize. If you can give me a second, I will look for that.
Okay, I'll keep moving and you can chime in when you're ready. All right, everyone. So community event announcements. Do we have any community events we want to share? Mari Carmen, would you like to share one?
Well, actually, Alondra, I know as a participant, she's going to share the holiday celebration for the springs.
Okay.
But I would like to give one on behalf of Sonoma Valley Community Health Center. It's regarding vaccine clinics. They are currently still every Wednesday from 5 to 8 until January 4th. And January 4th, we'll have more updates of how the future would look like. But if you really want to get your bivalent, you want to get it no later than January 4th, but otherwise we'll be there every Wednesday during this month from 5 to 8. Thank you.
Thank you.
Chair Turi, if I may real quick, Sonoma County Transit is scheduled for March agenda.
Thank you. Alondra?
Yes, good evening, everyone. My name is Alondra Marroquin, and I work with Sonoma Immigrant Services, and we are pleased to be partnering with the Springs MAC and the County of Sonoma, Fairmont, and the Sonoma Valley Fire for the Springs Winter Celebration, which is happening this Sunday from 2 to 4 p.m. at 22 Boyes Boulevard. That is at the parking lot next to the post office here in Boyas Hot Springs. So we're really excited and we hope to see you all there. We will have gifts, hot chocolate, cookies, and a bunch of fun goodies. So we'll see you there.
Thank you, Alondra. Karina, do you have any?
I do, thank you. I will start in Spanish. Para los miembros de la comunidad que nos acompañan de habla hispana, regresa nuestra charla comunitaria en el 2023. La primera charla del año será el jueves 12 de enero de 6 a 7 a través de Facebook Live y a través de Zoom. Vamos a estar abordando el tema sobre la salud y protecciones para nuestros trabajadores de campo, especialmente en esta temporada invernal. Así que por favor acompáñenos, también detalles sobre las diferencias, síntomas entre COVID, la gripe y RSV y qué debe de hacer para una vez que ha sido diagnosticado. También los servicios que ofrece el condado para todos estos trabajadores que año con año, día a día están trabajando afuera, como mencioné, especialmente en estas temperaturas extremas. Así que no se lo pierda, Juan Barragán estará con nosotros. In summary, Territory and members of the council and to our community, our charla comunitaria returns in 2023. Our first charla is on January 12th, Thursday, January 12th, from 6 to 7 p.m. on Facebook Live and Zoom. We will be talking about health and safety of our workers, differences and symptoms with COVID, RSV, and the flu, what to do in the event that you're diagnosed with either of those. Different services and resources available at the county level, as well as what the county is doing to protect our outdoor workers, especially in extreme weather as we're experiencing. So thank you very much.
Karina, are there anything else?
I don't think so, thank you.
Any other events from the council? Okay, seeing none. Okay, the update. So we are going to try to return in person in February. We will take a look at our COVID numbers and the health of our community and make that decision in January, but look for a possible return to in person. We will continue with a hybrid format so that we can get participation from community members who don't feel comfortable coming to a public space. But look for that in the future. We're excited about possibly coming back in person. Also, happy birthday to Joe in December. And on November 30th, we had a joint meeting of the North Valley MAC, the SVCAC and the Springs MAC. And the discussion was about the housing element and the study that's being done and the proposed plan for over 3,000 units of housing to be built in the county. There's at the Sonoma County website, there's a link to the meeting that you can view it if you like. It was a very good discussion. I feel like the council had lots of great comments about housing in our future here in the Valley. A meeting that you might want to watch. I'm excited about the event on Sunday. So I hope that there's a good turnout. There have been so many people working so hard to make that happen. Big thank you to the Fairmont and to Sonoma Immigrant Services and Karina and Mari Carmen and our fire department who have really, everyone has stepped up to make this happen. So it's exciting. And thank you to Jesus and Artiscape for decorating the fence. It's beautiful. So I will enjoy the season together. So thank you all. That is it for my chair update. There will be a public comment after every item. So people who are interested in commenting on items on the agenda, we'll make sure that you have that opportunity. I don't see Susan, so we'll skip over her update. Very good. Is Chief Aker with us? Excellent. Chief Aker, we're excited to hear your update.
Give me a second. Here we go. And there you are. Go ahead, Chief Baker, if you can hear us.
I can. Thank you. Thank you, Karina. Thank you, Chair Aturi. I appreciate the opportunity and the whole council. I appreciate the opportunity to share an update of what's going on with the with your Sonoma Valley Fire District. So first and foremost, you know, we're all in a cold spell, to say the least, right now. And one of the things that we are very concerned about, in addition to trying to support our unhoused population, is those that do have housing but may not be able to have the normal heating opportunities that most of us kind of take for granted. And so we've put out a number of public service announcements. They're on our LED signs, as well as social media and website, about home fire safety and heater safety, both from a fire safety concern with space heaters, as well as with carbon monoxide poisoning. And we've had issues with that, where people have brought in heaters from that are typically meant for outdoor heating, brought them inside, and there's reasons that heaters are labeled either indoor or outdoor. And so we've tried to really emphasize that within our communities as we go through this cold spell. Couple other things to highlight, and then I want to kind of generally highlight, and then I want to focus on what we're doing with the springs. So it's been a couple of months since I've had the opportunity to update the Springs MAC, but we have started to provide service to the Kenwood Fire District and their community. They were in a staffing crisis, and we were able to step in and help support them in order to continue to provide service to their community. In doing so, we actually upgraded the service, because our service is a paramedic-based service. Almost all of our members are paramedics as well as firefighters, and so that's the service level that we bring, and we brought that to the Kenwood community, and that is going very well, and we look to hopefully solidify that that staffing arrangement and that cooperative approach into the future with something a little bit more permanent. We're also actively engaged in the Sonoma Developmental Center planning process, and we'll be joining Supervisor Gorin on Friday morning for that meeting about the SDC planning process. Again, the fire district's overriding concern is community safety, and that kind of presents itself in a couple of different ways. One is we need to be able to provide service on site, and then secondarily to that is, in the event of an emergency, we need to be able to ensure that our residents both there and in the surrounding areas are safe and able to evacuate. And and then on a third level, we also are keenly aware of the impacts to our workforce, our first responders and others, with housing prices. And we want to ensure that we have an opportunity for workforce housing at the site as well. And with that, I want to transition into some good things that are happening here locally within the Springs. Our prevention captain, Gary Johnson, who I know is on the meeting tonight, he and our fire marshal, Trevor Smith, have been working with the Springs Fire Safe Council on a number of different projects, including the CWPP, which I know we'll be discussing next, mapping for shaded and strategic fuel breaks above Boys Hot Springs, identifying roadside vegetation management locations, and continuing to work with cooperators, including the Department of Public Works, Transportation and Public Works, CHP, on parking issues that affect both access and egress within the Springs. We're also part of a working group with the County of Sonoma on some bigger projects of fuel reduction as part of their FEMA grant award. And we're working with the Prevention Division of PRMD on getting additional funding for our chipper program, our roadside vegetation management, and defensible space inspections. So our defensible space inspections this year in the springs were very, very successful. We will again target that same area next year. We found that I think I've shared this with you before, but a 2-year cycle seems to be working best in terms of educating and then getting the end results that we all hope for, which is a better fire safe and protected community. A couple other things. Lastly, we're really excited. I know this was mentioned a couple of times, but we're really excited for Sunday and being able to deliver Santa. We did deliver him a couple of weeks ago to the Sonoma Plaza, and we're really excited to do the same for the Springs. We are doing a toy drive at all of our stations. So if anyone wants to donate toys, we are happy to accept those donations and make sure that they get into hands and families that that are in need. And then I think the last thing that I want to share is a thank you to Mari Carmen and the Community Health Center. Our crews really enjoyed coming out the other night, even in the inclement weather, but we really enjoyed the occasion, and it was nice to be able to connect with the community, and thank you so much for that opportunity and being able to be a part of that. So thank you. Happy to answer any questions that anyone may have.
Thank you so much, Chief Aker. It's always good to see you. Are there any comments from the council? All right.
No, just wanted to say thank you, Chief Aker, and precisely what you felt at the holiday celebration at the health center. That's what we want to create for our community. This is what it's all about, creating community and, you know, belonging and connectedness in our community. So bringing joy. Thank you so much.
Absolutely. I couldn't agree with you more. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there public comment? Okay, seeing none. Chief Aker, thank you so much. We always look forward to having you here, and I'm glad we're getting some rain. It's very exciting for everyone.
So, you and me both. Yes. Yeah.
Very exciting. All right. Take care of yourself, and we'll see you at your next update. Al, we'll see you on Sunday.
You as well. And thank you for the opportunity to be here. It's always my pleasure. And I will be sticking around for the next item, the Fire Safe Council update. But thank you. Great.
Thank you.
Okay. Happy holidays, everyone.
Happy holidays. Supervisor Gorin, I think you might be on mute.
So that's everybody's function, is to tell me when I'm on mute. Thank you. I'm sorry I was late. As you can tell from my snowy background, we're well on the way to packing in the snow for the snow base and the water supply. At least in Tahoe we are. We came up to Tahoe on Friday, just as it was about ready to snow, and it let loose on Saturday, and it didn't stop until Sunday. And we probably have about 2.5 feet or 3 feet of snow. Today was the first day I actually got out, walk the rows. You can't even walk across the meadow. It comes up to your thighs. So I was going to offer to bring like a car full of snow for Santa Claus. Well, maybe not. It probably would not make the trip for the 18th, but wouldn't that be fun to have a truckload of snow for Santa Claus? Lots of things going on. I participated in the board meeting on Tuesday. We spent a long time that morning interviewing our final two candidates for the county administrative officer position, two good candidates, and you probably know each of them because they are internal candidates, and we'll probably announce the selection maybe the end of this week or sometime next week. Still finalizing the negotiating contracts and things like that. So we have good talent in the county, and we're going to make use of at least one person with talent. It would be good for the MAC to invite the new CAO on at some point in the spring. Cheryl has done an incredible job, and it's her job to manage the board if we're at all manageable, and to be able to say no to department heads and boards saying, nope, too expensive. Nope, that report isn't ready. Nope, you're not authorized to do that. And she was like a deer in the headlights for the fires in 2017. She came out of the county council's office, but she rose to the challenge of navigating, helping us through all of the disasters that we've experienced, and certainly COVID put her to the test. So hats off to Cheryl Broughton. And you may be surprised to hear she is not quite ready for retirement. She's been hired as the county council for, that county of Napa. So she's going to be working in that county and using her incredible legal skills for that. And she'll probably navigate through our district, so I'll grab her for lunch or something. Couple of other things that happened. We did approve or receive the report from Ethan Brown, the interim economic development director. He and a variety of folks, including folks from Sonoma Valley, developed a strategy for going forward. And he's another one that I would suggest that you invite onto the MAC meeting to talk about how you see the future and how we can support our small businesses with our County Economic Development Board. He and Mark Bodenhammer and Tim Zahner have been doing tag teaming through COVID and reinforcing each other. And of course, Kristen Mattson works out of the Economic Development Board, and the Art and Public Places proposals will be coming forward at some point in the future. Tuesday, yesterday, was our last meeting of the year. Didn't disappoint. It was a pithy meeting with a lot of substantive issues, including the interviews for the CAO. But of course, our final meeting is on Friday. And the long-awaited board discussion on the Sonoma Developmental Center. And poor Ariel, she says, I've given up on your email because there are just many, many, many people sending us letters, not only to me, but to our state electeds and to the full board of supervisors on their thoughts about the plan moving forward, almost to a one, too large in scale, almost to a one, really concerned about fire, even though Steve Baker did a marvelous job of modeling. I warned him in advance, I may be shredding that modeling just a little bit. So I think you can tell where I'm going with my comments and trying to convince there only will be three other board members at the meeting. Supervisor Hopkins long ago planned a trip to now snowy Yosemite with her family. So she will not be there, but four of us will be. And we need to thank publicly Greg Carr, our planning commissioner, who did some really heavy lifting at the Planning Commission and introduced and incorporated many, many really great things in the plan, including increasing the numbers of deed-restricted affordable units and affordable by design units, even though they're market rate. And a number, of course, he and Eric really worked tag-teamed on widening the wildlife corridor to the north part of the campus. So I talked with him today to get some last minute prepping, what I should really focus on. And I just thanked him profusely for all of his effort. He really put time and energy into that. Didn't quite convince his colleagues to reduce the number of units, and we'll see where the board takes that up. So the 16th will be our final meeting of the year. And if the rotation of the board happens as I expect, Chris Corsi will become our new chair of the board, Dave Rabbit, probably our vice chair of the board. And I will be elected as pro tem, which means I can take all the glory and do not a lot of work. So that is all good. And we're gonna have a lot of strategic planning. I suggested to Karina and Hannah that the two MACs might want to take January or February and do some serious strategic planning about what you want to accomplish as a MAC, what kind of issues you want to tackle, how can you be effective? And I really want to thank you for all of your efforts on the Christmas celebration, the holiday celebration on the 18th. Karina assures me there will be no rain or snow at the event. It's going to be a perfect day, but come dressed for the weather with your holiday scarves and hats. We will have a fabulous time, and credit goes to all of you for pitching in and putting your time and energy into decorating and in inviting folks to come and join us at that particular location. So I will see you on Sunday. Thank you once again, and I can't end my comments without saying a big yahoo to Celeste Winders for pulling off her election. And I sent her condolences initially, but boy, those voters flipped it around, as they do, especially in Sonoma, interestingly enough. And congratulations, Celeste. And I thank you for your comments at the CAC, because I was listening to the housing element. Your comments were exactly right on. Do we want children to be able to live in the Valley? That's what we need to be focusing on in the discussion regarding the SDC, the discussion regarding the housing element, and any discussion regarding the population of students coming into our schools. We want to be a community that welcomes families and not price them out. And so I think that that's my goal, always has been, and that's what I'll keep focusing on. But Celeste, thank you so much for all that you are doing. I think you know what you're getting yourself into, but maybe not. You'll learn quickly. And we have three newly elected council members for the city of Sonoma. And congratulations to Sandra Lowe and John Gurney, elected mayor and vice mayor for the council. And both of those bodies will be working hard at hiring a new permanent city manager and superintendent. And I know that is not easy. So I'll sign off for now. I'll stick around a little bit, but my last message is, please mask up. And Celeste, I see you with your mask in your photo there. The numbers of COVID, RSV, and the flu have risen dramatically throughout the Valley, throughout the county, throughout the state. And I will reveal, I have a lovely, vivacious, kick-ass mother-in-law at the age of 96, ready to charge into revolution. She's so unhappy with the political scene at the national level, contracted the flu 3 weeks ago, and she is still not recovered. So it's one of the reasons I'm hurrying home from Tahoe, is that she needs help and a little pep talk to maybe get out of the chair, start walking, and recover. So if you know of someone who contracted the flu, please make sure you wear a mask when you're around them, but also ask, what do they need? Maybe they need groceries brought in. Maybe they just need a little holiday flower poinsettia to brighten their days. Let's take care of our families, our elders, our friends and family. And we're going to have our warming center open for a couple more days as this horrible freeze continues. If you know someone who is housing insecure, please refer them to the Veterans Building and make sure that they are safe and warm. So thank you so much, and I'll listen in on your conversations.
Thank you, Supervisor Gorin. I just want to check in with the council. We seem to be having some technical difficulties. Have we been able to resolve them? Is everybody okay? They're getting access? Okay.
And can I add one more thing about Steve Aker? He and I had a conversation earlier in the week, and it didn't dawn on me that they are under contract with the state to provide services, fire services, on the campus of the SDC. Their contract expires July 1st. So I've spread that information far and wide to figure out if we can get continued funding from the state through the transition. We absolutely need to keep you as a presence on the campus and throughout the valley. So thank you, Steve, for all that you do. Working on it.
Thank you, Supervisor Gorin. Can I ask again if everybody's okay with the technical, we've resolved the issues? Okay.
Secretary, Council Member Alcaraz is in the audience and we can't seem to get him to the panelist side. We've tried, so just to acknowledge that he's listening, but will not be able to participate in any voting or conversation. Okay. And also we see a number that called in, a 707-299. If you can identify yourself, please. Is that any of the council members?
No, doesn't look like it.
If it is not anyone, I will remove them to the audience just for purposes of this webinar.
Thank you. Okay, I think we've got everybody back and Jesus is in the audience. All right, sorry about that, Jesus, not sure what's going on. Any questions from the council for Supervisor Gorin? Seeing none. Okay. We do have a presentation from the Springs Fire Safe Council. Very excited, all the work they've been doing. Congratulations, Hannah, and the team that's been working on that. This is an informational update on the Community Wildlife Protection Plan from the Springs Fire Safe Council. And I think we're gonna have Ray Ouellette, our former vice chair of the MAC, Kaylin Notch, and Roberta McIntyre. So very glad to have you all here. And we turn it over to the Fire Safe Council.
Hello, hello.
I think we're going to start with having Roberta present. Right.
Yes.
Okay. Does that work for everyone? Great.
So, Hannah, I will need access to screen share unless you're going to run the slideshow.
Oh, Karina, can you help with that? Can she have access or should I screen share?
You will need to screen share, Hannah, because. Yeah.
Okay.
She's not being able to.
Okay.
You also know the speed that you need to run this through, so I think it's best if you run.
Okay. Sorry, I'm having to download it. I thought she was going to. Okay. Let me screen share. Share screen.
Looks like it's up.
Okay, great. Tell me when to go to the next slide, Roberta.
Next slide. Thank you guys all for having us here tonight. And thank you, Supervisor Gorin and Chief Aker, for your assistance with this plan, as well as all the other things you guys do throughout the county, particularly Sonoma Valley. So this is a real quick agenda. What we're going to try to do is stay within the time prescribed. And I have my timer running. So let's do it. Next slide. Again, my name is Roberta McIntyre. I'm president CEO of Fire Safe Sonoma. Fire Safe Sonoma is your countywide fire safe council. We've been working in the wildland fire safety and risk reduction space for 25 years now. Actually, this coming year will be our unofficial 25th anniversary. So anyway, with regard to a community wildfire protection plan, what we're doing here in this Springs area is a local community wildfire protection plan or local wildfire risk analysis. And the way we do these plans, we try to follow, for the most part, the path described in the Healthy Forest Restoration Act. And one of the key elements, the three key elements of that is, you know, to be collaborative in the process, to focus on structural ignitability, and to focus on fuels reduction. you'll see in a moment that we actually take it two steps farther than that. But fundamentally, what we try to do in this endeavor is to establish collaborative relationships with the team leads, the champions in the community like you all in the MAC, and the community members as a whole. And then we go through a process to create a plan that allow you to work towards reducing wildfire risk in the plan area. Also, I mentioned earlier, Supervisor Gorin suggested y'all go through some strategic planning. For the council piece of this, this plan can serve as a strategic plan moving forward, not a holistic strategic plan, but certainly a plan to work towards reducing wildfire risk. And then, of course, the work product can be useful in obtaining funding to get funds to address the mitigation needs that the plan will point to. Next slide. So fundamentally, it's just a risk assessment. I don't have a pointer, but if you look at how a risk assessment is typically conducted, you identify risks, you measure those risks, you examine solutions, you implement those solutions, you see if they're working, and then back to square one. You see what works, what doesn't, and then it's really an endless cycle. So with that said, this plan is a living document. It should be the project list that's attached to this plan should be reviewed annually. And the plan itself should be reviewed and updated between 3 and 5 years. No less frequent than 5 years is ideal. And then you can see the areas where FireSafe Sonoma is helping with in this endeavor is the three that are circled: identifying the risk, measuring those risks, and examining those some solutions to mitigate those risks. Next slide. So these are the four bins. So whenever you do a risk analysis, you need to know why you're doing the risk analysis. So these are the four topical areas of concern that we're looking at in this particular risk analysis. We're looking at, you know, the community's preparedness and evacuation, strengths, weaknesses, et cetera. Where we can improve there. Potential education and outreach opportunities. As I mentioned, we want to work towards reducing structural ignitability and work towards completing some prioritized fuel reduction efforts. Next slide. So this is the process we started beginning of the year. The teams were formed. Then we had a governmental stakeholder meeting, got input from governmental stakeholders, had a community meeting, got feedback from community members. We created a base map for the community and identified areas within the mapped area or plan area in terms of assets at risk and things like that. We conducted an analysis and we are working on, we have some priorities established. That list could be added to, of course. And then right now we're at a point where we have a draft plan and we have the plan available to share. And then downstream towards the end of the year, we want to get some feedback on that plan. And part of your homework is to take a look at the draft plan and provide us with some feedback. If you see any fatal flaws, please let us know for sure. Suggestions for improvement, edits, et cetera. We'll take everything under advisement. And if it makes sense in terms of the scope of this plan, we will try to fold those in. So we are here. And one of the things we're doing right now as we work towards putting the plan out there for review and comment, we are going to send it out. We only have it in English format now. We will be sending it out to have it translated in Spanish. So once it's translated in Spanish, from that date, once we get it out into the public from that date, we'll keep it open for another week for comments and feedback, and then we'll pull it in and close out the project. Next slide. So with that said, a part of our data analysis involved several data points. As I mentioned, we had some meetings, public meetings and community stakeholder meetings and governmental stakeholder meetings. And we created a set of maps with a lot of data on those maps that help feed into the analysis. We did a community survey collected information from community residents in terms of what their structures look like, et cetera, and what their concerns may be, et cetera. And also we put a lot, we did a lot of heavy lifting using the Sonoma County CWPP hub site. There's a really good set of tools on that site to establish wildfire risk indices and wildfire hazard indices. So we put the plan area footprint on there and got a lot of data out of that tool. So thank you, Supervisor Gorin in the County of Sonoma for creating that tool. I don't know that the supervisors really realize how useful and beneficial that tool set is for groups like Fire Safe Sonoma and for, you know, as a tool for us to do these plans for local wildfire CWPPs and FireWise community risk assessments. So it's a hugely beneficial, useful tool set. Much better, in my opinion, than the fuel mapper. And there's a couple of things out there that people are pointing to. This set of tools that the county has, it is just, it's amazing. So also, so all that data is fed into, on the far right, you see what looks like a little PDF. Yes, right there. So this data is fed into a tool that Fire Safe Sonoma built some years ago with funding from CAL FIRE. And the data goes into this tool, and then the tool will rank the plan area. And it'll also, for given topical areas, it'll tell us what areas need the most focus. So if you look close on the right-hand column of that, I don't remember whose it is, oh, Greater Occidental. You can look at, say, address signage says inadequate. Secondary travel, it looks like. Adequate. Where's another inadequate? Secondary road terminus, inadequate. So that tells us that those areas probably should become priority projects to address those deficiencies, and obtaining funding to mitigate those deficiencies is key. Once again, that's Occidental, not yours. But the image on the far left is one of our community stakeholder meetings that we held. That meeting was kind of fun. What we did there is we did bilingual in person, we did bilingual virtual, and we tried also to bilingual it streaming. We got 5 out of the 6. We weren't able to get it to work bilingually streaming, but on the other 5 attempts, we did okay. All right, next slide, hon. All right. So, we're at a point now where we have the draft and we're looking at priority projects at this moment. So as y'all provide input on the plan, please feel free to offer up some priority projects if you don't mind. Next slide, and I'm almost out of time. And then at the end, what we do is we finalize the plan. And what we do to totally final out the plan, this will probably happen in January. We'll send it around for signatures of key stakeholders, governmental stakeholders. So what we usually ask for is the district supervisor to sign off on the plan, state fire, which would be Chief Marcucci out the unit level chief, local fire, which in this case would be Chief Aker. And then I will sign it on behalf of Fire Safe Sonoma, and then a local representative from Fire Safe Council for Springs will sign off on it. And these signatures don't, it doesn't mean that these people are going to fund the project. It doesn't mean that you can go to Supervisor Gorin and say, hey, you signed off on this, so you got to fund these projects. It doesn't mean that at all. It just means that they've read the document and they agree with the findings and will support the findings as best they can as we move forward. Next slide. And I think you're up, Hannah. Thank you guys very much.
Yeah, we'll have Ray start with a local context.
Hi, can you hear me?
Mm-hmm.
Great. So the Springs MAC was formed in 2019, and early 2019, which was about a year after we were just getting over the 2017 fires. One of our first efforts was to form an emergency preparedness ad hoc. And out of that work came a resolution in September of 2020 to form two things, to a fire safe council and another, a Map Your Neighborhood organization, to start doing some grassroots work. Well, because we knew it would take a long time to get the fire safe council going. The demographic area is the same area of our MAC. The uniqueness, we were fortunate enough to have Roberta and her team at FireSafe Sonoma to work with them over the past couple years as we've been putting this together, almost 3 years now, 2 years, to kind of model what we want to have here, because it was too big to be a FireWise community, and it's larger than a lot of FireSafe councils. So ideally, hopefully, we'll be able to break it down into smaller bits with FireWise communities throughout the areas. We are the size of about a small city, and we have a very diverse demographic, economically, from very low income to some very wealthy people. So I think, let's see, I want to thank Roberta and her team, especially. We're fortunate to have them to support our work here through a grant that they received, and I'll hand it over to Hannah.
Okay, thank you. So some of our key findings are that less than 30% of properties have adequate defensible space. Roadside vegetation is also a big concern. Our roads tend to be very narrow. In our survey, 53% of respondents indicated that a motorhome and a fire engine would have difficulty passing on their street. And the other thing that I thought was really key to find out was that fires almost come into the springs, into the valley, three times via the Mayacamas Hills. So here you can see the history of fires in our area. The pink is from the 1964 Nuns Fire. The red is from the 2017 Nuns Fire. And then there's another fire that occurred in 1923 that's not shown, that I believe had a similar path. So all these very important fires are all kind of coming the same way. And so that led us to think that our big priority project should be creating shaded fuel breaks along the Mayacamas. And we're very lucky. Gary Johnson has intimate knowledge of that area and even has a map of where we could start looking at those breaks. This is a big project. You need to apply for CEQA funding first to do CEQA analysis. What that means for people who don't know, CEQA is a law that requires analysis of the environmental impact of any actions that we take. So we have to get money to do the analysis, and then we need to get more money to actually make the shaded fuel breaks. Some other projects that are a little smaller, a little bit more that we can do right now are roadside fuel management. So if anyone in the Springs knows of an area that is unsafe and overgrown on the side of the road, please get in touch with me or Gary Johnson, and there's money right now to address this. We'd like to educate people about defensible space. There are some new laws in California for high and very high fire areas about how you can have what you can or cannot have outside your home. So that's interesting. We also know that lots of people need to have improved addresses. Lots of people don't have very clear addresses. So when emergency crews get there, they can't figure out where the house is. We also would like to continue to educate the public about, when is it time to go, when there's an evacuation. And really, we need help strengthening the Fire Safe Council, because we are such a uniquely large Fire Safe Council. We're hoping to have FireWise captains throughout the area. So people who want to focus on, they can choose the size of the area that they want to focus on, but just people who can focus on their local area and go through the FireWise certification. It's not that hard. And there are insurance benefits too to becoming a FireWise area. And, Sonoma Greens is FireWise. So if anyone's interested in that, please get in contact with me as well. So right now, the next step is to have the public and governmental stakeholders provide input on our draft CWPP. Any input can be emailed to firesafesprings@gmail.com by December 27th. Please put spring CWPP comments in the subject line so your comment is easy to find. As noted, we have been trying to do this whole thing bilingually as much as possible. So there's a Spanish translation of the CWPP coming soon. And again, if you're interested in joining as a FireWise community or a neighborhood captain or just want to be involved, please email firesafesprings@gmail.com. And that's it. And we are so lucky to have worked with Roberta and Kaylin and Marika. I'm sorry. I mean, just we are so lucky to have worked with you guys. So thank you very much.
Does that conclude?
That's it. That is it. Let me stop sharing.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Oh my goodness. When we, I'm so glad that you had Ray do the history, because when we were talking about this 3 years ago, it seemed like such a big dream. And I'm just so, so happy that you all worked so hard to make this happen. What a great accomplishment. So thank you. Thank you. On behalf Woo-hoo. Of the council. Yeah. Yeah, Ray, thank you. And Hannah, you've just really led the charge. So thank you. And to Roberta for all your help. Deep appreciation. Are there comments from the council?
No, just thank you, Hannah, for your work and leadership, and Ray as well. We miss you.
I miss you guys.
I'd like to say the same. It's great work. It's very impressive. And I'm very happy you're doing it. Thank you.
Yeah. It's just a great, just fabulous. So thank you. All right. We'll go to public comment. I see a couple of raised hands. All right, we'll give 90 seconds for comments. Karina, are you able to promote? Okay, I think David is first. David, if you'd like to unmute.
Yes.
You have 90 seconds. Could I, hold on a second. Hannah, would you mind timing for me? Thank you.
On it.
All right. Thank you, David. Go ahead.
David Acker, Boyce Hot Springs. In regards to evacuations, like 2017, of course, it was really miles long backup on Arnold Drive heading south from Boyce Boulevard to Watmau. And so is part of this looking at not just when it's time to go, but the effectiveness of the evacuations of the routes? Having the law enforcement move traffic along, or having, or the other thing I see is that, you know, problems with the timing of signals that could really delay traffic. That's when it's totally unnecessary. It's like, is that something you're going to look at, or who do we contact about these types of things? Because it's not just when to evacuate, it's okay, we're evacuating. How do we get out of here in a timely manner? Is that being looked at? Thank you.
Thank you for your comment, David. So, Gary, did you want to say something?
No, I'm good. Just happy with the progress with the FireSafe's Council within the Springs, and looking forward to the final draft version and implementing those projects to make our community safer.
Well, thank you. And thank you for your service. I'll go to Bruce.
Hi, this is Bruce Flynn. I'm the emergency co-chair for Sonoma Greens, a FireWise recognized community in the Springs, I believe the first one. And I just wanted to say, bravo, Hannah and all who worked on this. What a great project. I'm not at all surprised that Roberta has provided such great guidance on it. But I also wanted to echo what David just said. One of the things that we have looked at here at the Greens that we're concerned about is not when to evacuate, but how. Many of our residents actually were part of the 2017 fires and ended up losing homes and moved into Sonoma Greens after that fire. and said it was a real mess. So the priority I just wanted to throw out for you guys, and we would, of course, from Sonoma Greens, be glad to help you, is how do we plan for what to do and how to move people out of the valley in the event of another fire. But mostly I just wanted to say, bravo, great job.
Thank you, Bruce. I do want to mention that Chief Aker wanted me to let you all know that Caltrans, CHP, Sheriff, Cal Fire, and Sonoma Valley Fire Department are working just on the issues that both Bruce and David have mentioned. So thank you, Chief Aker, for providing that information. I'm going to ask Josette to make a comment.
Hi, thank you. I would just like to know how and when we could get a copy of the draft to read. That's really all I that's my only ask. Thanks.
Thank you, Josette. Hannah, can you answer that?
I can email it to you, and hopefully we can, I don't know, Karina, if we could put it up on the Springs, maybe it's not appropriate on the Springs Mac page, but I can definitely email it if anyone wants to email me at Springs Fire Safe. Oh gosh, I need to know what the email is.
Maybe we can put it up again before we end the topic.
Yes, that would be great. If anyone wants to email me, or I will email you a copy, and hopefully we can post it somewhere publicly.
Thank you. All right.
Chair Turi, yes. I apologize. I'm kind of in and out of the meeting, but any material that is presented during the meeting is posted to the Springs Mac website. It does take us a few days to upload because there's remediation that needs to happen, but sometime next week, any material presented at tonight's meeting will be available. Thank you.
Thank you, Karina. Mike, go ahead and make your comment. Mike? Mike was having some technical difficulties early, so.
Unmute.
That's there me. You go.
Hey, I'm just going to mail my comments in.
Okay. Thank you, Mike.
Okay. Thank you.
All right. Our last comment that I see is from Mario.
Good evening, Chair Turi. Can you hear me there?
I can. Thank you.
Awesome. Well, I just wanted to thank the team for this amazing work, Hannah, and everyone who has been working on this important issue related to fires and safety. And you know, I just remember when the fires were happening, and people were, I mean, from the Latinx community were approaching me and really wanted to kind of like get involved and wonder, you know, how was it, you know, how they couldn't make sense in terms of why was it, you know, that the fire department could not put off the fires. It was just so interesting, you know, that the disconnect in terms of understanding processes and how it sort of work. So it just speaks to me of the value of the importance to really provide that level of education and engagement. And while I can appreciate, again, you know, the effort to make things to provide the translation for meetings and such, just, you know, it's like it's almost like, you know, oftentimes almost like I mean, just, you know, we're always sort of like looking for ways to fundraise to make things happen, but you know, just I guess being more I wonder, you know, sometimes I wonder, you know, what would be the best way to kind of like provide that level of education and access to information and just for the whole process versus just trying to, I guess, bring people up to speed at a one high level meetings and, you know, or in case of emergencies. It's just, you know, one of the things, you know, that I oftentimes wonder and are interested and concerned about, but I think that it's a great effort and I really appreciate it. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Mario. It is the outreach that takes place after this that will make a big difference. So thank you. All right. So seeing no more comments from our audience, I'll ask the council if they have any final comments. All right.
I just didn't say thank you yet. So thank you.
All right. Thank you again. Okay. That closes this topic. Thank you. And we look forward to hearing more as you continue the work. Thank you. All right. We have our next topic that is a hot topic in the Springs is our transportation and road safety. And I believe we have Jeff Weiss and Adrian Levy, and I'm not sure if there's anyone else. I thought I saw another Caltrans name. Lester Lee is here as well. And Karina, you've got them all? Okay. All right. So this is, we're receiving an informational update from Caltrans on the Springs Road and traffic safety improvements. And we'll discuss and receive a council direction on a letter to be submitted. Okay. So TPW received an approved encroachment permit from Caltrans to install phase one work on Highway 12 in the Springs area. Adrian Levy is going to give us some more information on that. Very exciting. The work to be completed is an update of the two crosswalks to higher visibility ladder crosswalks at Highway 12, Waterman Avenue, Highway 12 Sierra, and an installation of delineators on the edge lines of the Agua Caliente Creek, which is the Donald Street Gap, for those of you. Per TPW, in order to give the Springs community some results quickly, TPW devised a phased approach to perform improvements on Highway 12. They identified the crosswalk striping and delineators on the shoulder of the bridge near Donald Street as items that they could quickly get Caltrans approval on and install them with TPW forces. TPW is reviewing the permit conditions and will schedule a kickoff meeting with Caltrans, then schedule the work, weather permitting. It's possible they will not get approval to perform the work in the winter, so may need to wait for the spring and certain temperatures to apply the striping and glue down the delineators. We'd really like to thank the community and the MAC community were instrumental in making this all happen and the continued advocacy of Supervisor Gorin. And so we now have Adrian Levy and Jeff Weiss. And is there anyone else? I don't want to miss anyone.
I don't know, but they better talk now or we'll find out who they are.
All right. All right. Jeff, welcome back.
Well, thank you. Thanks for having us. It's good to be here at the holiday time. I mean, I wanted to talk about the Christmas list we have or the holiday list. But seems like some of it's been delivered before the holiday even. I think you guys have done an excellent job working with us, working with the county, and I don't want to call them gifts, but you've gotten it done by being very persuasive and knowing what you're talking about. I mean, that's impressive. I'm impressed with how much everyone knows about traffic and how it works and where it's going. And so it's that's good news. And Adrian's joining us to talk about it. This is all, we had all joined together, Karina, Hannah, I think Matey, you were there and the supervisor was there. And I believe someone from the county was there too. My memory is fading, but we all walked this in June, and I think that paid off. I mean, really see some of the issues that firsthand, and it was great having Adrian there because he's such a professional, and he can tell us what it means. I mean, we learned about the different kinds of crosswalks. There's the ladder, there's a cosmopolitan, there's the old school crosswalk. We looked at some of the timing of the lights. We looked on how traffic was being handled at the Verano Highway 12 intersection. And so what we've done is we've taken that information and we started to work on it. We haven't been able to complete everything. And I think everyone understands there's some limitations, there are competitions for money, but we're happy that you got the county to chip in to do some of the things that were on our list. That makes it easier for us to do other things. So with that, I would, I'm gonna turn you over to Adrian, and he's gonna talk about more of the technical aspects of it and what's going on out there in the Springs. Is that a good introduction, Adrian?
I couldn't have done it better myself, Jeff. Thank you very much. I'm looking for a president for my fan club.
Yeah. Well, I forgot to say that you're traffic engineer extraordinaire. So there we go.
Thank you. Actually, Jeff and Maita, both of you pretty much summarized what I've been meaning to say, but I'll go down a list of the things we discussed and the actions we intended to take and the status of all of them. I'd like to start with the Highway 12 intersection at Verano. That seems to be the biggest, the item of most concern. And surprisingly, I think, believe it or not, we have some low-hanging fruit there, and we just took care of it recently. So we've fine-tuned the signal timing. The intersection will operate more efficiently. It will take time for, especially the people that go through on a daily basis, they might notice it. But we're expecting that people will not be rushing through as much to pass the slower trucks and the slower vehicles. One thing we do, and I ask that everybody consider this, when we put up or we change a condition out on our roadway, we can't come back the next day and measure its effectiveness. We have to let the system come to an equilibrium. We have to let the motorists get used to it. And again, just some simple tweaking with the timing will make this run more efficiently. I'm thinking that over, between now and the end of the year and maybe even the beginning of January, we're going to be seeing holiday traffic. And we need to give it a month or two just to observe it. Wait to observe it, just to see that, again, this will come to an equilibrium. This is what we typically do in our business. We pick the low-hanging fruit, we pick the cheap and easy things that we think will be effective, and we elevate it up. It's an incremental approach. So that's what we've done at Verano. Maita, thank you for mentioning the Donald Gap and the delineators. This will be done by TPW. Caltrans has approved the permit to have them installed, and we'll be happy if you'd like to come out and meet with you as the installation date approaches. We discussed the Lomita Avenue bike path. Right now, what Caltrans does throughout our system is we have a monitoring program. We monitor our highways and we get reports from the CHP, from local agencies on our highways. And when there are collisions, we hear about them. And what we do is we respond to the most critical areas. The good news is the Lomita crossing did not show up as something that needs immediate attention. The bad news, or maybe the less fortunate news is, since it's not on the reactive list, we'll have to take a proactive approach to it, but that costs more resources, more time. If we want to do something there, we will have to compete with resources from elsewhere. Going down the list, the Siesta traffic signal, we discussed installing something called LPI, a leading pedestrian interval. It allows pedestrians to enter the crosswalk during an all red phase at the signal. It makes them more visible to motorists, and that's been done. Moving down the Central Avenue Highway 12 crosswalk, again, that is not on the monitoring list. There already is a high visibility crosswalk there with signs. And so what we did discuss was, putting up something with flashing beacons. Again, is it helpful? Yes. Is it necessary? It's not on our list of highest concentration of collisions. So again, that's something that would have to compete for resources and would take more time. We talked about the crosswalk at Sierra and Highway 12. And again, that was approved with the Caltrans permit for TPW to install. Same with Waterman. That one has been approved by a Caltrans permit. And finally, we were told that the street light at the Sierra crossing was dim. What we do is we go throughout our system every 90 days and we inspect our street lights to make sure they're functioning correctly. So as Jeff said, we walked through there back in June, that was 6 months ago. So that light has been inspected at least twice. And it is working and it is bright. So that finishes up the list of issues we discussed back in June.
All right, anyone else from Caltrans want to chime in? Also, I should also say that there was a project called the Hooker Creek and the Sonoma Creek Bridge Replacement Project. Those are two bridges that were you're suffering from scour, which the water comes down, spins around the foundations, and over years, the bridge starts to tilt and is no longer viable at some point. And that's happened to both those bridges. That's on Route 12. And we're gonna start that project in the fall. It's been delayed, but we are gonna start that again in the spring. We can talk about that more later, but I just wanted to inform everyone. You've seen us out there cutting trees. cutting trees is done during this time of the year because it's not nesting season. So we're just getting ahead of that to cut the trees down before birds nest in them, because then we can't cut them down. But we will start those projects, I believe, this spring. I mean, I'm 90% sure, unless something happens. Both those bridges will be undergoing construction this upcoming year.
Thank you, Jeff, for that update. Does Mr. Lee want to say anything before we move to council?
Yeah, no, this is Lester. No, I don't have anything else to say. I think Adrian and Jeff did a good job.
Thank you.
Share your email, Lester.
Again, I would like to thank you all for all the work that you've done to help us out and to, you know, that, as you say, that walkthrough we did in June was super powerful. So thank you again for the work that's being initiated and taking place. And this is an exciting MAC meeting. So I'm really super pleased with everything that's taking place. So thank you. I'll go to council to see if there are any comments and then we'll go to public comment. Hannah?
I just wanted to start by saying thank you. And Adrian, I missed this. Could I get clarity on what is occurring at the two crosswalks, the one at Sierra and Highway 12 and the other at Waterman, please?
Certainly. So Sierra and Waterman, there are already crosswalks there. And more visible crosswalks will be installed. They'll be refreshed. I believe the one at Waterman is simply an old style traditional crosswalk with two lines. And I believe Sierra, there's one that crosses Sierra, a similar one. The one that crosses Route 12, well, okay. And so those will receive what we call a ladder style crosswalk. It will have those two horizontal line. Well, it'll have those two traditional lines with broad striping going between them. And it looks like a ladder. That's why we call it a ladder style crosswalk. And so, yeah, both intersections will have the. And then we also, it's not just paint, it's something called thermoplastic. It's a thicker, more durable type of paint. And we put glass beads in there, little tiny glass beads. And that's what makes it more reflective at night. Mm. So it's not just two white stripes anymore.
Thank you.
Great. Thank you.
Are there any other comments from council? I also, before I go to public comment, I just want to acknowledge that it has been 20 plus years of work for the Springs to provide safe streets from the people who started 20 years ago working on the sidewalks, meeting and making all that happen, to the streetlights, to the current work that's happening. So it's really, this has been a strong community effort. And I just want to acknowledge all the people that have done all that work for so long. And I believe that some of our current council members are a part of that work as well. So I just really want to acknowledge that. Marie Carmen?
Yes, I just wanted to say thank you so much for all the improvements that have been done, especially the West Thompson line and Highway 12. And I don't know if this is appropriate or not, but I wanted to ask if the lights belong to Caltrans, because, you know, with the holiday spirit, I was looking at other places that actually put wreaths on their lights. I think one of our next goals would be to light up those lights, at least from, I would say if we can at least do like from Boys Boulevard to Central Avenue, that right there would be a great start. Do we need to ask you permission, or I'm sure there is some kind of process, but we would love to start working for you ready for next holiday season.
So when you, just for clarity, please, when you say lights,
The lights that were done from McDonald's all the way to Agua Caliente.
The lampposts.
Okay. So there's two types of lampposts out there. There's kind of a a traditional lamppost, and then there's a more decorative lamppost. The traditional ones are, they belong to Caltrans. They're inspected and maintained by Caltrans. The nice looking ones belong to the county. And so you could pretty much
do I haven't seen that. I haven't seen the difference between them, but I will, maybe we can get pictures of which one's which. That would be super awesome.
Yeah. And honestly, I think they're okay. Lester, maybe you could help out with this. Do you think an encroachment permit would be necessary for holiday decorations on the county maintained lampposts?
Yeah, I'm not sure. We have reached out to our encroachment group. Jeff, do you know? Have you got this question before on the other communities?
I haven't. I'm surprised that I haven't. And if I have, I've probably done what you're doing now. Say, you know, talk to permits and we'll find out.
Yeah.
I'll tell you what, before I log off this evening, I'll send an email to our permits office. I'll CC Karina, get her in the loop, and we could have a better answer.
Yeah, at times it may get complicated because of we may have O&M agreements with the county, you know, with other entities on, you know, equipment that we have in our roadways, right? And so we need to follow those to make sure who operates and maintains those, and then, you know, if we're encroaching on those, right? And so.
Yeah, I saw them in Napa. I was like, wow. I was like, why didn't I think of this before? Now it's like Christmas around the corner, but I'm surprised nobody else has asked, and we have a very long, almost mile and a half of lights. I was like, I'd be happy with just some in front of the Boys Boulevard.
Thank you. And you know, we'll come back and ask you again. So thank you for looking for if you well, learned anything.
It's not too late for next year.
All right. Thank you. Okay. We're going to go to public comment. I see one raised hand. David?
Yeah, David Iker here again. I wasn't going to talk about this, but and the discussion earlier about fire safety and evacuation, there's an issue with the delay of Siesta Way and Highway 12 when heading technically eastbound, but you're actually kind of heading south into the city, where across from Siesta Way, there's a driveway. And across that driveway, there is a pedestrian signal, which always turns to allow pedestrians to move, even when no one pushes it. And during the time, the eastbound traffic is delayed, I've timed it multiple times, 9 or 10 seconds. Now I know, you know, you put in delay to allow pedestrians to start, and I'm all for that. But there's been backups at time in that direction, heading into the city where there hasn't been before this. And so, and I went in traveling in San Francisco they have a number of lights with the delay. And if I've timed them, there's only 3 or 4 seconds. And I think it only takes about 5 seconds to cross that driveway. So I'm not sure why there's a 9 or 10 second delay from the lights turning from red to green in that direction. It seems to be excessive and probably was not meant to put that intentionally. Thank you.
Thank you, David. Okay. I don't see any further public comment. Is there any final comments from council? All right. Thank you to Caltrans. Thank you, Jeff. Thank you, Adrian. Thank you, Lester. We really appreciate you coming back and sharing the work with us, and we look forward to seeing the improvements, and I'm sure we'll be speaking again.
No, thank you.
Thanks.
Congratulations, right. Too.
Thank you.
Guys have done well.
Thank you for having us.
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you. All right, take care.
All right, thank you.
All right, we're going to go to our our Springs Community Plaza ad hoc update and letter approval, and then we're going to take a break. So this is the Community Plaza ad hoc follow-up to the November meeting. We're going to discuss and receive council direction on a letter to be submitted to the project developer, and we'll take public comment after the item. And this is to make a decision on whether we're going to write a letter. There has not been a date identified for the follow-up meeting yet, but that's where we are with this item. I know that Hannah and Jesus, and I believe Joe, represented us at the meeting, that the two meetings that happened at Flowery. So we'll hear their update. Thank you.
I'm having some internet issues, so can everyone hear me?
Yeah, yes. Seems to be the event of the evening here. So yeah, we can hear you here.
Okay, so I guess, you know, we don't have anything to present. Here are the ideas that we came away with. We would say that there was a mixed response from both meetings, with people wanting public improvements, but a lot of concern about Mattson's track record. We also heard a lot of concern about the format of the meetings, in that questions were only received but not answered. Additionally, we heard questions about the location, such as, is this the best place for a plaza with a small size of the area? Other things we heard were that the community wants resources to be directed to existing infrastructure that needs repair, such as Larson Park or our roads. There was, you know, a strong desire for the plaza, but kind of a neglect in the planning aspect. So that's what we have here. It's hard to say we can write a letter exactly with that, except to say that, of course, people want improvements in their where they live, but there's a tremendous amount of concern about the process and about the reliability of the Mattsons as development partners. So that's where I'd leave it. I don't know if Jesus would like to chime in or Joe.
No, I think you had it pretty correct. I think beyond that, I feel like we're continuing at any special meetings or when we join other folks, there's always a lot to say on this. And I feel like there's still even public comments trickling into us via email about this. It's so much at the forefront too, that I think beyond us representing and talking about things we spoke about at our meeting prior, I think it's smart for us to wait for that meeting to come up and understand what they're taking away from all of that feedback, to then understand what was left behind, and also we'd have the ability to kind of understand with the new plans coming out what kind of makes sense. But yeah, for the most part, Hannah nailed all of it.
Can I ask a couple clarifying questions? So what I think I hear you saying is that you may want to wait for more information before we commit to writing anything about the situation. Okay, great. Thank you. Is that what you were, that's Joe, you and Hannah are both in agreement with that?
Yes.
Okay, yes.
Thank you. Are there comments from the council? You all are pretty quiet tonight.
I have one. I don't know if you can see me. I was having my own internet issues tonight too. Oh my gosh. It was a tech issue evening. I want to say that I too have received a lot of communications from the community regarding the reliability of the Mattsons as in terms of construction improvements and building, and just quite frankly the fact that most of the properties they've bought have been sitting dormant and falling apart. But the other part too is ensuring that all members of our community feel welcome in all spaces, and that's another piece of the communication that has come to me. And I just want to make sure that we sort of address the elephant in the living room on that, because that has been a big piece of the communication. And I think it's important that, as a MAC, because our community comes to us and communicates their concerns to us, that we ensure that we communicate that in a public space as well. And that has been one of the concerns. And so I want to, you know, just get that concern out there and clear. And I also want to thank the public. I want to thank the public for really being so vocal and sharing their concerns and being so active in our community. I think that's one of the things that makes our Springs community really special is the fact that we do live in a community with a lot of people who really care about what happens here. And that's what makes us a community with a big capital C and all capital letters, right? Because we are a really, really active vocal community. And so I just want to thank the public for all their public comment. I want to thank the public for reaching out and for their emails and their concerns and for just being such a great community and caring so much about all of us and caring about their neighbors and being so active. So I just wanted to communicate what has been communicated to me and to acknowledge our community.
Thank you, Celeste. Iris, I think your hand is up.
Okay. I think it's naive to expect that Mattson organization is going to present with a report that is going to reflect as much of the negative opinion that seemed to be expressed in the meetings toward them and their, well, and what they were doing. The other thing is I realize with horror, actually, because I live really close to all of this, to Boys Food Center, to the, what's called the landing structure and to the post office area, that they could have all three of them torn up at the same time. Lanning is torn up. I saw recently that they're planning on, that they're working on moving people out of Boys Food Center. And it is this, you know, it really is in the center of at least the business area and the congested highway of the Springs. Those are, you know, definite concerns that I have. Also seeing communications to the Index Tribune, I haven't seen anything that was actually in favor of the Mattson's project at the plaza. Thank you.
Okay, so, but what I am hearing about whether we're gonna write a letter or not is that we want to wait until we have more information. Is that still what I'm hearing? Okay. I'm gonna go to public comment. Oh, wait, Money, did your hand just go up?
Yes, sorry, thank you. I just wanted to put it out there that I think that, you know, despite, you know, everything that is going on and the different opinions, which is, you know, I forgot who said it, but, Celeste, pardon me, about community engagement, correct? Because that's what, you know, we advocate for. I think it was very helpful to actually be very clear about two different things. One, that the confusion that the street still belongs to the county and is not owned by the neighbor that owns the historical post office building. So that was very clear because that was a big confusion. And speaking to different community members, they thought that is where it was going to be, like inside where, like, the post office is, and they take away the building. And then another big concern that I also heard was just the gentrification of the rumor going around that this was to take away, like, take out Latinos out of the community. And so I, you know, was able to debunk some of those myths with people that were saying, well, they want to take us out of the Springs. So not necessarily. And so I just wanted to put that out there, that at least it also has been able to bring, upfront topics that were not being spoken about, even with this happening, because this even had happened before the topic of gentrification happening, even before the Madsens bought this. So that just made it more clear that people were scared of that, which is already what we're knowing with the housing crisis. So just wanted to put that out there. Thank you.
Thank you. So I'm going to move to public comment. We'll have 90 seconds on this. Okay, hold on. I'm going to move. Oh, you got it, Karina. Okay, thank you.
Hi.
Go ahead, Veronica.
Thank you very much. It's Veronica Annapolis with Wake Up Sonoma. First of all, one of the things that I'm very concerned about is the language that's used in the scoping agreement to determine the outcome of the comments that are made in the public engagement. For example, I've heard not only once, but twice now, the response of mixed responses. When I hear mixed responses, it indicates a 50-50 split. And that was not the case. It was more like a 7 or 8 against, and maybe 1. Lefevre and Madsen are now the largest non-winery property owners in the Valley. Many of their properties are in various states of disrepair and vacant. Thriving businesses that we once had with tourists are now just sitting there. What's in it for them? My best guess is depreciation, tax write-offs, and dark money. So my question to Susan Gorin and the Sonoma County Board of Supervisors is, how can you partner with a documented organization that doesn't respect the rights of women, gays, minorities, and immigrants, and that has no track record of finishing anything that they start? So we need to separate the concept of the community plaza, which is a great one, which I worked on the Springs specific plan, but we need to separate the plaza from partnering
with the
Madisons.
Veronica, thank you. That does conclude your time. Thank you.
Thank you. Josette?
Hi. I have one ask request and two questions tonight. As we only have one more meeting before this goes to the supervisors, I would like to request that we have a totally different type of meeting, one that does not follow the structure of the last meeting, one that allows all community members 3 or 4 minutes to speak and ask questions, one where these questions will be addressed and answered by Mr. Madsen and Supervisor Gorin. And then at the end, if the questions are not answered fully, that we are allowed to speak again and state that our questions have not been answered. This meeting should also have Zoom access so that more community members can attend. Question one, why can't the $1.8 or $1.9 million be kept for a plaza at another location or not involving the Madsens? From what Supervisor Gorin has told me, there is nothing that requires it to be at this location or in partnership with the Madsens. And question two, why, if the scoping agreement was signed in July, did the county and the Madsens wait until November to have the first meeting with our community? And if my time's not up, I want to say that I'm sorry to miss the Holiday Springs celebration, as we will be at our neighbor's annual latke party. Thank you very much for listening.
Thank you, Josette, for your comment.
David, go ahead.
David Eicher again. I oppose the underground parking. The existing parking should remain and the plazas should be put in the old Uncle Piety's property to the north or in Larson Park. Any problems with the current parking area would be exacerbated if it goes underground. One, I've heard concerned about mischief or illegal activity currently at the site because there are no eyes in the area as the one building is now vacant. Parking underground has almost no eyes in the area. At least now you have passing motorists and pedestrians able to see what is going on and report any mischief. Two, the underground parking may become a place for homeless. Unlike private property where the owner can call the sheriff to remove trespassers, on public property, it can be very difficult to get the homeless to move to shelter elsewhere. If it is deemed okay to allow homeless to encamp in underground parking, the money would be much better spent on actual homeless shelter. Three, if the ventilation system is not properly maintained, it could lead to carbon monoxide issues. Four, underground parking will actually reduce the number of parking spaces. Five, my friends owned a loft on First Street East with underground parking. The complex had to add a gate to stop the skateboarders from skateboarding down the driveway into the parking garage. So no matter who builds this, should not have underground parking. Thank you.
Thank you for your comment. Mary?
Mary, go ahead.
It's Mary Sampson from Wake Up Sonoma. I'm going to reiterate something that's been said already, but in a little bit of a different way. Again, regarding the current Plaza Post Office parking lot proposal, we oppose partnering with the Madsens. They have not completed or complied any of their projects in the Springs. As everyone has already stated, we've got Lanning, Moon Mountain, Boys Food Center. These things have been in process now for over 8 years. They have a poor track record of community vision. They have a poor history of planning, and they have a poor history of improvement. The Madsens now own over 60 properties that we are aware of. They have properties in other names and other LLCs that we may not be aware of. Research proves that monopoly power destabilizes communities. We already know that our community is being destabilized because of all the anger toward him. We do not know what they will do. We do not know what they will do with the post office building. We do know one thing. They will likely not follow through. We do not want Madsens to buy any more properties, and we do not want the county in any way to do business with them. Thank you.
Thank you, Mary, for your comment. Anne?
Hi, I'm Anne Scarf, a Springs resident for 32 years. Similar to so many things that were just said, I would like to see to separate the community plaza concept from building a Madsen parking lot at the post office building. We really question the use of taxpayer funding for a private underground parking lot for the now privately owned post office building. The current proposal for a plaza at the Madsen owned property has not been developed through a transparent process required for meaningful community decision-making. By that, I mean there is an abundance of language in the scoping agreement that directs the developer to do outreach and seek community engagement. While that sounds good, there is no description of exactly how that public input is to be managed, collected, and analyzed. The language states, "Developer will duly consider community input regarding the proposal in its proposed proposal." This seems to have Team Madsen as the keeper and final arbitrator of the feedback and opinions being provided by the people. For example, Susan Gorin indicated that the results of the two meetings were mixed, when in fact it was 7-1 against the project, if not more. So we're asking the county and Supervisor Gorin for a true community meeting without the Madsens to discuss how to best invest the $2 million.
Thank you. That does conclude the time.
Thank you for your comment. Seeing no more hands, we'll go back to the council for any final comments. I think we'll bring this back in January as a check-in to see.
Chair, it looks like
Do we think we can get him?
I'm going to try.
Okay.
Jesus, are you able to hear us? It's not going through.
Yeah, I don't know.
Says that he has an older version of Zoom. Jesus, are you able to call in?
Oh, there he is.
Okay, let's give it a second.
I know we have the chat disabled, but can he put it in the chat?
He can also email me because we don't activate the chat. Jesus, are you there? Looks like your audio connected. Is he in the Spanish channel, Juan? I'm sorry. Juan, what were you saying? Oh, I can't hear you. Sorry. There you are. Okay. Jesus, are you able to switch to the Spanish channel? And maybe through the Spanish channel, if you can hear Juan? He is texting me. Let's see. Yeah, I'm not sure what's going on. Jesus, if you can just call in, that would help us out a lot. Or if you can email your comments, and I will let Charitari know when we've received them. I'm so sorry, Charitari.
It's okay.
Looks like tonight is tech issues for everyone.
Yeah, it really is. Everyone's having a tough time. So I'm wondering if there are any other comments from council. As I was saying, I think we move this to the January agenda. I hear people saying that they would like to have another community meeting. I hear that loud and clear from a number of people. So maybe that's something that can happen. Mari Carmen, did you have a comment?
Yes, sorry. I just, from what I heard, and I think would be important to be eventually in our letter, is that people do want a plaza. That's the main thing. And so we would also, if this site doesn't work, it's also very important for the community to say, where would it work? Also, you know, focus on that. And because at the end of the day, the community does want it, not in this situation precisely per se, but at the end of the day, it's something that the community has been wanting for over 30 years. I just wanted to put that out there. Thank you.
Yeah, that's a great point. And I think I'm advocating for another type of meeting that people can, that we can provide some more space for people, because it's something that people definitely want to have a place to talk about. So, okay, I'm going to close this item.
Territory looks like Jose, Jesus is back.
Is he?
We see him.
Would you like to make a comment, Jesus? Can we hear you?
Can you try to unmute?
Yeah.
Yes, we did.
My only comment is regarding the the plaza. I would just want to say that we had a very like they say, the very divided opinions. But I just would like to think that everybody think about the end goal of the plaza, which was for me a center of where people can reunite and people can connect and just build community, and that's all I really wanted. And I hope that if the plaza doesn't happen, or if it happens, that we focus on that, and that the children of the Springs deserve a plaza, people from the Springs deserve a plaza, or if people from the Springs just deserve something where they can all be together. Thank you.
Thank you, Jesus. Glad you made it. Okay, again, I'm going to close this item. We'll bring it back in January. Again, advocating for another type of meeting. We are going to take a break. So it is 8:29. We'll take a 10-minute break. We'll make it 11 minutes. We'll come back at 8:40, and then we'll close out the agenda with the remaining items. Thank you all. Enjoy your 11 minutes.
I just realized I neglected to press pause. So there's an 11 minute silence.
That's okay. All right. So the next item on the agenda is the Springs Mac logo design. We met as an ad hoc. And Joe, do you want to share what we discussed? I'll give him a minute. There he is.
So main thing is I felt like we wanted to be more of a public competition. We talked about having a possible prize money. And the big thing for outreach, one of the biggest thoughts was to have it kind of broadcast by Creative Bridges. So that's tons of creative arts organizations in the Valley come together to comprise that. But I think the main thing we talked about is, I don't know that it's for us right here to come up with what exactly is in it. And I think by opening it up to like the broader community, there may be themes that we don't, that we're not even thinking about that could be represented well in said logo.
Yeah, and I think we also decided that we were going to take this on in January after the holidays and get people involved in providing some input and also designs. And I think we discussed us getting it down to, after we received some submissions, for us getting it down to two or three to be selected from. And we're hoping to involve local artists, youth, whoever might be interested in submitting a new logo design for us.
Yep.
Are there any comments from the council on the movement forward on this? Any suggestions, comments? Hannah.
Did you guys talk about how we would decide? Would the public vote on it? Would we vote on it? I guess my question is, I don't want things to just be a popularity contest. But yeah, that's my thought.
Yeah, totally. I'll just answer that before we move on. So we had discussed between Maite, Celeste, and I coming up with like the finalists rather than it being a public vote all the way through. As much as I love the public, there is a great track record for folks to upvote something that's awful because it's funny to do it that way. So we figured we could narrow it and then make it more a public vote.
Thank you.
Mighty Conman?
Thank you. My only question would be, I guess it's kind of lateral to the new logo. Are we still able, can we still purchase a banner with the current logo meanwhile for our outreach efforts, or do we have to wait until we actually get a new logo just because it's kind of like delaying in a sense, you know, finalizing our current outreach materials? Just wanted to put that out there. Thank you.
Yeah, I think because we're on a tight budget that we would have to wait to purchase the more expensive items we've been looking at. Celeste?
Yeah, just to sort of jump in too, when we're talking about, you know, narrowing it down to finalists as part of that process, that piece is important because it can become sort of just a go up vote mine and who has the most friends. But what we really also are looking for is a logo that not only represents the community, but is really usable for us to overlay onto materials and doesn't have, you know, isn't so busy or has so many parts that when we try to overlay it on a tablecloth or overlay it on flyers and those kinds of things, that it then becomes difficult for us to actually use. So, you know, that piece of, you know, people creating their creations and submitting it, I think that one of the areas we're going to be looking at when we're looking for a new logo is that piece. We have to, it has to be easy for us to use on a variety of materials, just from a logistical and just graphic design perspective.
Thank you. Okay. Is there any public comment on our logo process? Jesus?
So as part of, well, actually I was looking into creating a runner with the logo and the Springs Municipal Advisory Council spelled out. And like, as related to Mari Carmen's question, can we, if it's possible, it's not expensive. I was looking at it, it's $8.99 to just create one of those for the time being. Just saying.
Well, I'm gonna leave that to Karina and Supervisor Gorin and their thoughts on it. I don't know how, yeah.
And we defer back to you. It's up to your council. It's your budget. I think you guys were on the right track. You've developed, you know, this logo. People recognize the Springs Mac logo now. You sort of are finally making your way into the community, especially after 2 years of, you know, COVID and not being able to be out in public. I know that over the summer, you guys were discussing promotional material, and Sunday's event would have been perfect to have all that material. So it's, you know, obviously your council decided to redesign and you won't have any printed material other than a flyer with the existing logo, but, you know, like a tent or backdrop or tablecloth. I think what was decided, Jesus and Manny, from the previous meetings is that everything's tabled until the new logo arrives. So no outreach material other than flyers with the existing logo. But again, it's up to your council. If you all decide you want to print something for $8.99 for another event, I don't know that you'll have it in time for this Sunday's event, but for something maybe the Springs Picnic, because I don't know how long this process will take, given that you meet on a monthly basis, and by the time you do outreach and have the finalist and then vote on it, it could be another easily 3 to 5 months. You could have other events in the meantime. I know the other Niño is in April, for example. So what are you going to do? What are you going to use for outreach material that day?
Hannah? You're on mute.
Thank you. If it's really just $8.99, that's pretty minor. We need some branding. So if it's really just $8.99, I don't see that as a big issue. But that's just my thought.
Any other suggestions? What does $8.99 get us?
A burrito from Chipotle.
No. Can you send Karina the what you were looking at?
Sure, I can definitely do that.
Thank you.
Of course.
Or I don't know what program you were using to look at it.
I was designing it on Amazon Prime. Amazon, sorry.
All right. I mean, if it's a small investment, and we get something out of it for whatever the next upcoming event might be.
So for public awareness and for as a reminder to the council, if this is something you want to do, it needs to be agendized. And I know that I've been working with Chair Turi and Vice Chair Perrott to finalize the January agenda. With holiday schedules, we're kind of working on an accelerated agenda, and I don't think it's going to make it into January. So you're looking at February. So right there, you're already looking at 2 months just to potentially print an $8.99, you know, table runner.
Well, I'm going to make a suggestion that the ad hoc meet in the next week or two to come up with a process so that we can get it out there as quickly as possible in the beginning of January, so that we can move this forward as quickly as possible. Because we do need something for the spring. So we'll put a placeholder in the February agenda for potentially purchasing something with the old logo in case we need that if we don't have this new logo in place. Is that a reasonable next step? Okay. So can we put a placeholder on the February agenda for that? Thank you. Okay. All right. Oh, nobody had any public comment. Okay, we're moving on. Ad hoc and community projects update. So we have Community Voice, Mari Carmen, Maite, and Iris.
Yes, Karina, would you mind sharing the budget for the holiday celebration, please? No, I don't.
Yes, bear with me. Oh, I have multiple screens open, so I have to find it.
Okay, well, meanwhile, Karina shares that screen for us. I again wanted to thank our community voice ad hoc, Iris and Ms. Maite, and very grateful to our community nonprofit partner, Sonoma Immigrant Services, the Fairmont Mission Inn for their support in Sonoma Valley Fire District. We are really excited to be able to really put the icing on the cake on an event that has been done before, but never has it been done actually giving out holiday gifts to children from 0 to 17.99. I guess 18 still counts as child too. Oh, well, technically not. But so we are super, super excited to be able to offer this joy in this community event for the Springs community. And so we hope that you all can help spread the word. And it will be, as Alondra mentioned, from 2 to 4 at the 22 Boys Boulevard property area or the street. And we would love also if our MAC members could volunteer. So we are looking at the heaviest tasks of helping Santa Claus with the line there for pictures and helping also the gifts that Santa brings, you know, to provide to our community children. So I don't know who would like to volunteer, who has time for maybe set up during the event or help break down. Please.
What time do you need people there, Mari Carmen?
Well, the setup, we're going to start probably around no later than 11 in the morning. And then we're setting up the Armando's Party Rentals is coming to set up the tent so that we can have a good space for Santa when the fire district brings them in case it's raining or it's too cold for him and the kids. So we're having a 20 by 40 tent. And then we will need help kind of setting, arranging the gifts on the table. So I think latest, if somebody can come either like around 11:30-ish to 12:30-ish to help with that setup. And then if they can arrive before that event, if they want to help with either with Santa or with handing out the gifts during the actual event, or a breakdown would be, you know, starting at 2, like 1:45-ish, if they can't make the event but want to help with the breakdown of the event.
Okay. Thank you, Mari Carmen.
This is Mari. I think I heard you say that the breakdown would start at 2.
But oh, sorry. 4. No, yeah, it's 2 to 4. See, thank you. I'm so glad that I have my colleague here. The event is from 2 to 4, so the breakdown would be at 3:45. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Monica Cutterman. Jesus, we're going to break it down before we start it. Jesus.
Break it down.
Marty, I wanted to, well, I want to ask you if I can volunteer to help set up, but unfortunately, I cannot help you break down the whatever.
Well, set up would be great.
Okay.
You can send Karina an email. She can send out to the ad hoc group and our partners to put you in as a volunteer.
Yeah, I'll be more than happy to do that. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Jesus.
If I may, Chair Turi, we encourage the entire council, if you're available, to make presence. Yes, absolutely for setup. Yes, absolutely for bring down if you're able to, especially during the event. I think this is your first opportunity for your entire council to make presence, this new council, and be introduced to the community. There's going to be a DJ with a microphone, and it'd be great to introduce yourselves and, you know, go shake hands and kiss babies, as they say, but get to know your community. So if you can, it would be wonderful. I know it's something that has been agendized, so hopefully you will be able to. And I know that the ad hoc will take any help they can from any community member who is willing to provide any support.
Great, thank you. Okay, we'll see everybody on Sunday. The bike rack ad hoc, Joe and Maite.
Apologies, Chair Tree. Mary Carmen wanted me to share the item.
Oh,
just so we know the transparency of the budget really quick. So as you can see from here, we have in the blue, we have the total amount of money that we have in our budget, $1,000 from the Spring SMAC and $3,000 from an anonymous donor, totaling $4,000. Currently, what has been already contracted or in process of being paid or already has an invoice is the DJ for $200, the tent for $500. We were able to purchase gifts at Target for $1,416 with 19 cents at Target, which was really amazing because we actually were able to get 160 toys, which originally we were looking between 100 and 150 with a budget of 3,000. So $500. And so we were really able to get a lot of gifts for only for much less than our original goal. Holiday gift bags for $213.57 at Ross. And we got a Polaroid camera. And so the $400 includes the Polaroid camera plus four rolls of, I believe there's 40 in each for film. So we're also looking for a volunteer to help take pictures. And then a winter backdrop for Santa Claus from Amazon for $27.50. So that's a total, a current total of $2,798.58. And we have a remainder right now of $1,201.42. But we are looking at purchasing $150 worth of churros. And then we will still have a remainder for other miscellaneous things needed as they come up. So we just wanted to share this with our community and with the MAC of what is currently is being spent. Thank you.
Thank you. That's great. You guys are good shoppers. Okay. Bike rack. So the bike rack art project is moving forward. There's a bike rack that we're using as a sample, and it's going to Artscape. And they will do some experimenting with it to figure out what substances will stick to it and what they can use. They plan on getting community input on what we want on these bike racks. And they predict that the project will be completed by April. So that's the target. And that's where we are with the bike rack. Did I miss anything, Joe?
No, the main thing is I just need to find time. It's not going to happen this week, but to get the bike rack from Grove to Artscape. But we'll make it happen.
All right. Awesome. I think we have a public comment on our ad hocs.
Yeah. I just wanted to bring up, I saw that the tent size was 20 by 40, and that may require a tent permit from the county PRMD office, which will add to your budget. So if it's under 20 by 40, there is no permit required. Just a heads up on that.
Oh, thank you so much for letting us know. So we are still in time of them requesting a 20 by 30 because they gave us a discount. They gave us the price of a 20 by 30 for a 24 by 40. So is that okay with the ad hoc that we change the tent to a 20 by 30 instead? Yes. Okay. We will go ahead and do that. Thank you for the heads up, Gary.
Thanks, Gary. No problem.
Can we just roll up a corner and make it 20 by 39 or?
All right. We've already heard from the Plaza ad hoc. We're going to move on to the community picnic. Celeste, do you want to say anything about what you're thinking for that? I know we're not thinking about that till the spring, but we can't hear you.
Sorry, because I didn't unmute myself. no, there's not much to update because we are thinking about this like late spring, early summer. So I'm thinking, you know, as after the new year, let's start looking at dates and we can make a decision. Do we want to do it in the spring or do we want to wait till school gets out? I think that's kind of like the big question, mainly because of weather. Spring weather can be a little unpredictable. We all are hoping we get lots of rain. We don't want to discourage the rain or not wish for it. So yeah, I'm thinking after the new year, let's start looking and just making a decision. Do we want to do it in the spring or do we want to wait till maybe the first week of summer when school gets out?
Thank you. Facebook page. We have one. Please like us. It's pretty new. We have the people who are on our former group have not migrated over yet, but there is getting more traffic than it was. I don't have much more to say on that.
I have a question about that. I know that I don't know exactly who has access, but I do think that it does need to actually be sharing more often. So just wanted to put that out there. Thank you.
Well, and a reminder too, we can now share the posts from that page to our personal Facebook pages. Just a reminder on that too. That was the biggest, one of the big purposes of shifting how it works.
Okay. All right. Is there any public comment? So the things that we accomplished, all those I just want to close this by saying all those accomplishments that we talked about today, the transportation, the Fire Safe Council, those all started as ad hocs. So that just shows the power of this group and what they can accomplish. So that start out as something small and end up being some pretty significant changes. So thank you all. Okay. Karina, we have a budget update. Is that correct?
Give me a second. It was still uploading, but now I think it's available. Here we go. Okay. I don't know how much detail you want me to go in, or we can have a record meeting and just get to the bottom of it. Current available budget is $7,093.75. Once all your outstanding invoices actually come through and get paid, including the allocated budgets for your community projects, you would be down to $3,368.75 to cover your ongoing expenses for the remainder of the fiscal year. So as of now, $1,600 has been spent on minute-taking services, $2,386.25 for your interpretation services, $1,050 for broadcasting. You had the one-time rental maintenance fee for your in-person meeting. And keep in mind, once you go back to in-person meetings, you will have these fees associated, either janitorial or rental fees for any facility that you decide to use. And then your community projects as of now have been Dia de Muertos, the holiday lighting, the picnic, which has not taken place, the Altar Springs Garden, $250, the Dia del Niño, which has not taken place, $1,000, and the Winter Celebration for $1,000. And I'm happy to answer any questions.
Is that all encumbered so that $3,000 is what's remaining after those other items have been?
Correct. So again, currently you have $7,093. If and when all those invoices come through and those projects take place, because we have not received invoices for those projects that you allocated those budgets for. So they're still in your bucket of money.
Okay.
If and when they do go through, you're down to $3,368, again, to cover your December meeting expenses through June 30th.
Okay, thank you. Any questions on the budget? I think when it's time to request a new budget for the new fiscal year, I think we need to have an increase, particularly because we provide translation services for our community and not other meetings do that. So it's hard to be equitable in this situation. We're going to need a larger allocation for our interpretation services.
And Chair Turi, as a reminder, last fiscal year, your budget was $10,000 and it was increased to $15,000 specifically to cover interpretation costs, because that's where the bulk of your budget was going. So you've already been increased by $5,000.
Inflation, we need more. Thank you. Iris?
Maite, I'd like to second that. It is an expense that I think other groups are going to see coming. Mm-hmm. We're just ahead of the curve, and I do need to have that taken into consideration. It is expensive.
Okay. Any other comments on budget? Okay. Any public comment on budget? Seeing none. Alrighty, closing the budget item. Consideration of future agenda items. I just want to share with you what we have coming up. In January, it's dedicated to mental health and suicide prevention. Are your hand up, Mari Carmen?
Oh yeah, but after you do the reading, I don't want to forget to raise my hand.
All right. So our January meeting is dedicated to mental health and suicide prevention. We have Sonoma County Behavioral Health, RISC, Sonoma Valley Mental Health Collective, and perhaps some others lined up for that meeting. February is economic growth and housing, and March is transit. Are there any other suggestions or comments? Mari Carmen.
See, that's why I didn't want to forget raising my hand, because then I forget. I think that I would like to see on the agenda inviting the new police chief from the city of Sonoma. So know his plan for emergency preparedness and how we could work together, since we were so accustomed to having a great relationship with Chief Orlando, which I'm going to miss dearly. And also, I would like to hear from the Community Center and the Center for Volunteer Nonprofit Leadership regarding their volunteer list for emergencies. And I would also like to see what they're doing in terms of bilingual promotion and bilingual, and also recruiting bilingual volunteers. Thank you.
Thank you. Iris?
Thank you. Although none of those, I don't believe any of those fit into the category that I'm going to speak of, but what I've noticed is that when we receive presentations from many county departments, they are PowerPoint, and we don't really have our questions answered about them. I really noticed that with transport. Oh dear, the bus service, and I can't remember the name. And it seems to me that if we're going to receive PowerPoint presentations, and we're really not going to be able to ask questions that are substantially answered, I would be in favor of having the PowerPoint sent to us so that we can look at them ourselves before the meetings and kind of cut to the chase. I really like looking at the PowerPoints ahead of time. It's easier to read on my computer screen. I can digest it at my own pace. And I know that might sound kind of like a radical solution, but I think it would save time too. And really, the people who appear from the county, it's taking up their time to present a PowerPoint that we can read on our own.
Thank you, Iris.
You're welcome.
Karina, did you want to say something?
I do, making note of the future agenda items. I also added Supervisor Gorin's suggestion to have the new county CAO come present. And I just want to make a quick comment about presentations in general and material, because I think I haven't been as diligent with my deadlines because I've been very flexible with COVID and people's schedules. And I understand that the council, volunteer their time to be on this council, but there have to be deadlines. Sometimes I'm not receiving material from the council and county departments and organizations. I'm receiving material the day of, day before, 2 days later, even when they've presented at the, at the MAC meeting, it slows down my process to upload everything to the Springs MAC website for community access. And I had several community members reach out to me and asking for material for tonight's meeting that I didn't have, unfortunately. So I just want to throw it out there. I need to be more diligent, but I also need, for you guys to step up and send all material. The agenda gets posted 2 weeks in advance of your meetings. Technically, it's not supposed to be posted, or we don't have to post up to 72 hours before a meeting, but we do 2 weeks to give the media and the community and yourselves, enough time to plan. So given that, when your ad hoc updates are coming or your projects are coming, and technically I should have all the material by the Friday before the meeting, so I can send it out Monday morning at the latest to our FYI list. You do have an FYI list, just so you know. There's a list of over 200 people that follow the MAC. They reach out to me saying, hey, I need the agenda or I need the material, especially on a hot topic, and you know what those are. So again, just to be mindful of that for deadlines, I'm always flexible. You'll see, you know, an hour before your MAC meetings, I'm sometimes sending you material that I receive, but that's not really the process. And Iris is absolutely correct. You guys should have time, you know, at least 2 days before your meeting to review all the material if everyone sends it in advance. And also, again, just for our community's awareness, I send out what I have in hand as it comes through. And yeah. Oh, just to go back to the Sunday event, if you all do attend, just a reminder, Brown Act, you can talk about holiday, you can talk about kids, you can talk about gifts, you can talk about the churros, you can talk about everything except for MAC matters. The only people that are allowed to address any MAC matters are the ad hoc, because that is their event. And I understand that the ad hoc will be doing some surveying of the community. Everyone else, just you're making presence. Thank you.
Thank you. I also want to speak to the power of public meetings. And the reason that we hold these meetings is so that the information is public. So if we are the only ones receiving PowerPoints ahead of time, I mean, which is good. I think Iris's suggestion is valid. We should have them ahead of time. But the part of this is to have that information be public for our community. So that's just another piece of this, of the reason that we do this way. I'm losing track of whose hands are up. I did pretty good up until that point. Karina.
It's okay. One more thing to address Iris's point about asking questions. Sorry, my birds are extra cheerful today. You do have the right to ask questions of any of your presenters. And if you feel like they're not addressing your questions, I would bring it up. And keep in mind, they give their presentation and you have counsel opportunity for questions immediately following. So if at any point, Iris, you feel like they're not addressing your questions, sometimes their answer might be, I don't have the answer, let me get back to you. I mean, we can't control that, right? That's just the way it is. But if you feel they're not addressing your questions, please, please speak up, because you're absolutely right. They're taking up your time and your space to bring a presentation forward, and they should address your questions and concerns.
And as someone who gets put on the spot and asks questions all the time, sometimes they don't have the answer in that moment. So they should say that and say they'll get back to us.
I'm fine with, I don't have the answer. Yeah. It's just when it's evasive that it really bothers me. Thank you.
Understandable.
Clarity.
Yeah. All right. Any other suggestions, questions, comments from the public about future items? I am going to suggest that we do perhaps sponsor a meeting that people can talk about the plaza and where that may or may not be and what it may or may not include. And I just think that in the spirit of transparency, which we are all trying to accomplish here, that we should create that space for our community. So maybe Karina and I can talk about that later on, what that might be. Okay. All right. So I want to thank you all for an amazing year. We are approaching the holidays. I hope you all have a wonderful, wonderful time, whatever you celebrate. If you don't celebrate, just take some time for yourself. People are stressed out right now and fraying at the edges. So please take some time for yourselves. I want to thank KSBY, Lynn Marie, our awesome interpreter, Karina, Supervisor Gorin's office, and all of you for making this work meaningful and powerful. So have a beautiful, beautiful holiday. And can I get a motion to adjourn?
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
All righty. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Have an amazing, amazing December. Thank you all. Bye.
Happy holidays, y'all.
Next year.